Dans la collection Pavillon, les éditions Robert Laffont nous proposent pour cette rentrée littéraire de septembre 2020 un formidable roman historique que l'on doit à Kieran Millwood Hargrave. Elle est anglaise, elle a déjà publié plusieurs romans, mais aussi de la poésie. Et cette fois-ci, Kieran Millwood Hargrave nous emmène en Norvège. Nous sommes en 1617. Le roman démarre au nord-est de la Norvège, près du cercle polaire. Nous sommes sur la presqu'île de Vardo. Et Maren, la jeune héroïne, a 20 ans, elle vient de perdre son père et son fiancé lors d'une tempête. Ils sont pêcheurs tous deux. Il y a d'ailleurs une quarantaine de pêcheurs qui sont morts au cours de cette tempête. Et les femmes de Vardo vont devoir reprendre elles-mêmes la mer pour survivre. Parallèlement, à quelques centaines de kilomètres de là, au sud de la Norvège cette fois-ci, à Bergen, c'est la jeune Ursa qui se voit contrainte d'épouser Absalom Cornet, qui lui-même va être envoyé à Vardo pour faire une chasse aux sorcières puisque nous sommes en plein conflit interreligieux. Voici le point de départ des Graciers, le nouveau titre de Kieran Millwood Hargrave que nous retrouvons à Oxford puisque c'est là-bas que vous êtes installé. Bonjour Kieran Millwood Hargrave. Merci d'avoir répondu présente à notre invitation. C'est une grande saga historique qui relate des faits authentiques que vous nous racontez dans ce roman, des faits liés à la chasse aux sorcières, donc au XVIIe siècle en Norvège. Comment avez-vous eu connaissance de cette histoire et pourquoi avoir eu envie de vous en emparer?
So actually, the first I came to hear of it was through a piece of art by Louise Bourgeois, who is one of my absolute favourite artists. And I saw on the BBC webpage that her final major installation was this incredible metal chair that's sort of encased in this sort of cage of smoked glass. And there's a flame coming out of the centre of it. And I clicked thinking, oh, I must be able to go and see this. It must be in Paris or London. But actually, it turned out to be on a tiny Arctic Circle island called Vardo off the northeastern coast of Norway. So I started to research about why it was there, and it's part of a memorial to 91 men and women who were killed in witch trials as part of Scandinavia's largest witch hunts. And the research and the intrigue unspooled from there. The facts were there sort of bookending the novel. So the novel opens with a storm that kills 40 of the island's fishermen and essentially leaves behind this matriarchal society, this society of women. And that storm actually happened on Christmas Eve in 1617. And then we know for a fact that in 1621, 4 years later, these witch trials start. But in between, there's this complete gap, this complete silence about how these women actually survived. You know, they lived in a time where women weren't self-sufficient, they weren't encouraged to be independent. So it was really interesting imagining how these women who had been brought up to rely on their male counterparts actually found the strength to survive. And for that reason, it ends up being quite a hopeful novel.
Il y a deux personnages féminins absolument incroyables dans votre roman. Présentez-nous Maren et Ursa.
So originally, the story was only told through Maren. You experience the storm through her eyes, through her body. And I carried on telling the story like that because obviously the main action does take place on this tiny island and that claustrophobia is quite important to the mood and the tension of the novel. But I got about a third of the way through drafting and it all just started to feel very heavy, quite bleak, quite similar in feel. And I knew that I needed to introduce another point of view, a counterpoint to Maren, and that's where Ursa comes in. So while Maren has always lived on Vardo, she is sort of hardened to life there. Ursa is a completely different person. She is a ship owner's daughter from Bergen, and her father has fallen on hard times and essentially marries her off to this man he meets at a port who is travelling north to Vardo to try and bring this community of women back to heel. So she is quite soft by comparison to Maren. She seems quite, I suppose you could even say weak by comparison. She's lived a very sheltered, protected life. But what I love about these two characters and putting them together in the novel is that they really bring out the opposite in each other. So you see Maren start to soften through their friendship and you see Ursa start to find her inner strength. And their friendship and their character development is really what drives the novel forward.
Il y a évidemment d'autres personnages qui sont importants et font avancer le récit. Nous pouvons évoquer Kirsten.
So Kirsten is the woman who emerges as the sort of de facto leader of Vajra after the menfolk are killed. Her husband is likewise killed, and she immediately takes charge. She organises fishing boats for the women to go out so that they can actually feed themselves. She butchers the reindeer who travel north in winter, and she means they can survive. Without Kirsten, they wouldn't be able to survive. And for this reason, quite a lot of readers have said, you know, isn't she a bit contemporary? Isn't she, are you putting your expectation of what a woman should be onto these historical figures? And my answer to that is that she is actually given permission to be so independent by her husband when he was alive. So Kirsten and her husband couldn't have children. And so they actually form this partnership over and above a usual husband and wife relationship, and they give each other purpose in different ways. And so her husband actually enables her to become this independent woman who knows how to fish, knows how to butcher, and ultimately can lead the women through the hard times after the storm.
Le décor et les ambiances sont très importants dans votre roman. Comment les avez-vous imaginés et pourquoi donner au décor et aux ambiances une telle importance?
For me, setting is everything. It's where my story blooms from, and I do have quite strong ideas about how the places we're from form us as people. I'm very much aware of the, you know, the small island mentality that's unfortunately coming through in British politics at the moment. And I find it very interesting to sort of look at how especially islands can form their inhabitants. So setting was always going to be the most, it's almost a character in this novel. You know, it takes on its own personality. And especially in Vajra, it's in the Arctic Circle. So it's really extreme weather situation up there.
Kiran, vous racontez dans ce livre un événement historique, mais vous écrivez surtout un roman plein de fougue et de drame. Comment avez-vous construit la trame du roman? Quels étaient peut-être les pièges à éviter pour écrire une histoire fictive inspirée d'un fait authentique?
So I was lucky with the structure because it was already there, you know, for me in the material that I'd first encountered the story through. So I knew it was going to start with this storm because my books always tend to start with these very strong images. I really want them to feel almost cinematic in their scope and their narrative drive. So I had that storm and this character watching this terrible event unfold. And then 4 years later, you have these witch trials that begin on this tiny island. So I knew that was where my novel was going to end because I felt like I'd already read a witch trial novel. I felt like that story has been told and told very well and told many times. So I was more interested in telling what happens in between. How do we get from this small community of traumatized women into them being persecuted as witches? That was where the interest was for me, was in that interim 4 years. So that was my structure. And then in terms of historical fiction, I always say that I'm a reader who writes. So reading is the most important thing to me, and it's where I learn most of my lessons for writing. So I particularly turn to books like Alias Grace by Margaret Atwood and by the works of Rose Tremain, and really looked at how they create a sense of place and time and really weave through these little details, but you know that the research, it never gets in the way of the story. And so the way that I approach writing historical fiction is that I will be character-led, setting-led, plot-led, and then I will weave in my research about what they eat, what they wear, how do they keep warm, what do they build their houses from. These things are very important and you must use them well to be respectful, but above all, I want to tell a really great story. So those research details come later.
Nous sommes certes au XVIIe siècle avec cette chasse aux sorcières, mais il y a peut-être des parallèles avec notre époque contemporaine?
Always. I mean, history repeats, and I wrote this novel at a time when a certain world leader was using the phrase witch hunts over and over, and it was just, there was a lot of anger that went into this book, but there's also a lot of comfort to be taken from the fact, I think, that we have come through hard times before and that there are lessons that we can learn from the past if only we could look for them and learn from them. It's easier said than done. But absolutely, I very much saw this book as an opportunity to fold the past very closely into where we are now, into our present, and to try and draw very strong parallels. And I think this is what historical fiction does so well, is it allows you to explore those parallels without feeling like you're delivering a message. You know, you can show rather than tell. And that's what I always love about the best historical fiction, is how it makes me feel so close to the past and also shows me the present in a whole new light.
Merci beaucoup, Kiran Millwood-Hargrave, de nous avoir reçus depuis chez vous, depuis Oxford. Votre titre sort en France en septembre prochain, Les Graciers, dans la collection Pavillon aux éditions Robert Laffont. Un formidable roman historique, une très belle fresque historique traduite par Sarah Tardy. On ne rappellera jamais assez l'importance des traducteurs. Ça s'appelle Les Graciers, c'est l'un des temps forts de la rentrée Robert Laffont.